All right, so hopefully everyone has had some time to get connected to this webinar, and we'll go ahead and get started. So welcome to the International Crane Foundations From the Field webinar series. Many of you have heard this all before, but just wanted to let you all know that we are recording this webinar, and a link will be posted on our website in the next coming days. And as questions pop into your head today, please use the question and answer function to post questions, and we will do our best to answer them at the end. And then I also wanted to let people know that my presentation today utilizes some photos and videos, and those were actually pulled from a video monitoring system, a camera system. So some of them might be a little bit blurry and they might be lower quality, but hopefully it still helps to illustrate some of the things that I discuss. I would first like to express my sincere appreciation for the sponsors of this webinar, Dick and Jane Dana. Thank you so very much for your support. And I'd like to also introduce myself. So my name is Cyndie Gitter, and I'm the Assistant Curator of Birds. With me, I also have Jessica Colvin. She's one of our aviculturists, and she will be helping to moderate the questions and also assist with answering the questions as they come in. And Jess and I are members of ICF's Crane Conservation Department. And so some of you are probably wondering, well, what is the Crane Conservation Department? It's sort of a very vague title of a department when the whole entire organization does crane conservation work. So the Crane Conservation Department is really everything you see on the screen and more. That's not all of us in the photos. But Crane Conservation Department, or CCD as I'll refer to it sort of moving forward. We work here at ICF headquarters in Baraboo, Wisconsin, and our department consists of 6 full-time aviculturists and multiple interns. And we really are a unique entity at ICF in that we work directly with all 15 species of cranes every day, 365 days of the year. And I also like to kind of think of our department as having 3 main categories of work that we do. So one of the main things that we do is we're tasked with the care and management of ICF's captive flock of adult cranes. And we really work within 3 main areas here at here on site at the headquarters. One is the public exhibit area, which many of you are probably aware has been undergoing renovations for the past 2 years. And then we have a second facility, which is our off-exhibit breeding facility known as Crane City. And then our third area is our isolation chick rearing facility, where we costume rear whooping cranes for reintroduction. Another part of our departmental work is we are very involved in captive species sustainability. And that's typically through the Association of Zoos and Aquariums Species Survival Programs. And so the species survival programs are conservation programs where zoos work with each other to follow transfer and breeding recommendations for a particular species. And this helps to maintain or improve the genetic diversity of the captive population. And that captive population can be used for public outreach, such as a lot of zoos use them for reintroduction purposes, like whooping cranes and sort of other species as well. And then our third sort of area is one that many people are very familiar with if you are familiar with ICF, and that is our department assists with the whooping crane reintroduction program, specifically as it pertains to the breeding of whooping cranes, chick rearing, and then release of the young birds. So today my webinar is going to focus on a part of our departmental work that really is the foundation of every other piece of our work. It's really what we build all of our work upon. And so this is the socialization of crane pairs within our captive flock. And socializations really help us to develop happy, healthy birds. And happy, healthy birds help ICF fulfill its mission to conserve cranes. And so today I'm just going to walk you through that socialization process. And I titled this the way that I did. Oh, I'm sorry, guys. I titled this the way that I did, just call us Cupid, because I kind of like the idea of people whimsically thinking about us as Cupid. And so people sort of have this idea that we kind of pick out birds, we plop them together, and they magically take to each other and just start producing chicks. But the truth is there's really the truth is pretty much different, is really different than that. So a lot of times with our socializations, there can be quite a bit of confusion, some frustration by both the aviculturists and the cranes. And you can toss in a little bit of manipulation, particularly from the aviculturists. And then given enough patience and time, everything usually will work itself out. So it's a little bit different, but I kind of like this idea of thinking of us like Cupid. So I'm gonna go out on a limb and say, if you're watching this webinar, you're likely familiar with cranes and are aware that generally speaking, cranes are social species that form lifelong pair bonds. And in the wild, cranes would typically choose their own mates. Usually looking at size, sort of a bigger, taller bird is probably more fit to protect a territory, to raise chicks. Disposition and behavior, usually kind of the same thoughts. And so they'll kind of choose these, look at these things and choose a suitable mate. I've even read that there's some evidence that cranes, whooping cranes in particular, will actually go through sort of a courtship period for 2 to 4 years. So they'll kind of hang out with a bird when they're younger and kind of see if that bird is going to be a suitable mate. And so raising chicks and putting a lot of energy into chicks, you really want somebody, a partner with you that can help you out with that, because there's a lot of energy that is expended in that. But obviously for birds that are in captivity, we have some constraints that don't really make cranes finding their own mates work. And so for us that work with exotic animals in captivity, one of the main goals for us is to always sort of mimic the species' natural history as best as one can. So we really want to have cranes in that social situation. And so we kind of work around those constraints. And so we provide for their social needs by providing them with a companion. And a lot of times in captivity, having a companion can help birds be less anxious, more confident. They will explore the exhibit a lot more, get more use out of their exhibit space. They'll express a greater diversity of behaviors, and all of that will hopefully lead to cranes being reproductive and having offspring of their own. So socialization helps us meet our primary goal of sort of providing the best life that we can for our birds, but they're also, socializations are also really crucial for the work goals for our department. So socializations create inspiring pairs of ambassador cranes that connect people to their wild counterparts, the ecosystems and the communities that they all share. And when people connect with things, they learn to care about things. Socializations also allow us to produce pairs of cranes that are necessary for our captive propagation goals, which I talked a little bit in one of the intro slides. And so one of those programs is the AZA-SSP, or the Species Survival Programs, which I mentioned before, is a program in which zoos collaborate to help maintain the genetic diversity of captive populations through breeding and transfer recommendations. So sometimes in order to fulfill those breeding recommendations of the SSP, you have to start from scratch, and you're usually bringing one crane from one institution, a second crane from another institution, and you're bringing them together in possibly a third institution. And all of that occurs through socialization to create this pair of cranes that is genetically diverse and will help kind of maintain that genetic diversity and health of the captive population. But really what program our department spends the most time on is whooping crane reintroduction. And what I always say for our captive flock is that if the cranes aren't helping to save their own species through these SSP programs or through public outreach, they are helping to save whooping cranes. So socializations are really important for species like Siberian cranes, red-crowned cranes, white-naped cranes, black-neck cranes here at ICF, because those pairs are often used as surrogate incubators for whooping crane eggs. And you won't have fertile whooping crane eggs or whooping crane chicks if you don't have well-socialized, tightly bonded whooping crane pairs. So it seems kind of obvious why we socialize within our flock, but how do we decide who to socialize? So we typically stay within the species, that's kind of an obvious one, and we evaluate a pool of candidates, kind of who are our single birds within the flock. And it sounds a lot like crane matchmaking. And we kind of look at all of our single birds. And so we usually start by figuring out which individuals are the most genetically diverse. And so you want birds that obviously are not related to each other breeding together so that they produce healthy chicks and help that captive population. But there are other things that we can, There are other things that we consider, like the individual's disposition, or you can think of it as their personality. We consider what their rearing history was like, what their previous pairing history was like, or experience level is. Have they bred in the past or and raised chicks in the past or not? And usually that all comes with age. So if you have a bird that was parent-reared, you might find it more difficult to pair it with a bird that was hand-reared, just because they're going to behave a little bit differently. And we also have some birds within our flock that are cross-fostered. And so that means they were raised by cranes, but they were raised by a species different than itself. And so sometimes that can prove to be challenging as well, where the birds maybe can't figure out each other as well. Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. A lot of times it works to our advantage to actually pair an older, more experienced bird with a younger bird. So it can help calm the younger bird down if they're a very excitable individual. And sometimes you can even create a more successful breeding pair if one of the birds already knows what it's doing and the younger bird can learn as they go. So that's sometimes very helpful if you're hoping to have that pair reproduce or become surrogate incubators in the very near future. And ICF really has one more advantage over many other institutions, especially in the case of whooping cranes. So you might have remembered that I mentioned earlier that cranes in the wild choose their own mates. They see something in the bird that they like, but obviously in captivity, you can't have that happen. And so if we try and base birds just on genetics alone, sometimes you have the potential of hitting a roadblock if the two birds that are genetically a good match don't really get each other in terms of their disposition or their personality. So ICF actually has the ability to control the genetics, for lack of a better word, through the use of artificial insemination. So we have the luxury of considering pairings based on personality, which hopefully birds will take to each other a lot easier, sort of enjoy each other a lot easier and want to reproduce, but maybe their genetics aren't the greatest. We can actually kind of control the genetics of the offspring through artificial insemination. So now we've kind of discussed why we socialize, who we socialize, and now we're sort of going to walk through how we actually socialize. So most of our socializations occur during the fall and the winter, and for very good reasons. Staff are done with chicks and they have more time to focus on this time-intensive work. The birds' hormones levels are dropping as they come into breeding, as they come out of breeding season in the spring and summer. And then the cold weather actually works to our advantage as well. So because of the lower reproductive hormone levels and colder weather, cranes tend to be less aggressive, or it's so cold it's really not worth the energy to be aggressive. And so that really helps us out. And then also many of our socializations take place in our off-exhibit facility known as Crane City, which usually has less overall disturbance or activity. And typically our birds are gonna stay within this area as well, especially if they are entering into the breeding aspect of our work. And then finally, another great advantage to ICF is the fact that facilities here were really built with cranes in mind. I know that kind of sounds funny, but it really means that we have facilities that can house cranes directly adjacent to one another. And so this creates an environment for prospective mates to get to know each other without actually having full access to each other, which can be dangerous in sort of the first stages of socialization. And as the fall approaches, like it is right now, we have our birds housed side by side, sort of getting to know each other, and we're finalizing a few important pieces of the socialization. So typically before physically putting birds together, we do research on the socialization history of each individual. And this gives us the ability to predict how the birds might react in certain situations or with each other. And this also allows us to see where challenges are going to be and think about how to set up the socialization to be successful. So when I talked about when we're pairing birds or how we decide who to pair with, a lot of times if one of the birds that we're thinking of socializing has some previous pairing experience or actually has been socialized before with other individuals, those records that we already have on that individual will be really helpful to us moving forward with new socializations. And so obviously observations of the bird's true interactions is crucial, and that requires remote monitoring. So a lot of times if people are within the same environment as the birds will respond very differently than if the keeper, staff, or aviculturists are not there. That's sort of an obvious statement. So we have a lot of these cameras where we can actually watch the birds without being in the same space as them. And so one of the photos here just shows what our remote camera system looks like. And this camera system allows us to view live video feed as well as recorded video. And recorded video is really important because within your socialization, you'll reach a point where the birds are spending longer time periods together. And by being able to review through the video, we can see how the birds interacted with one another, because as much as we would like it, the aviculturists, we ourselves can't sit there for 8 hours watching the birds. So another crucial piece, which I sort of touched on before, of the socialization is actually just a paper record or record of the bird's behavior and interactions. Again, this is not only important for future socializations, but it provides a way for us to look for patterns, for challenges, or for ways to adjust how we can proceed with the socialization. And that's sort of where manipulation comes into the socialization. Again, all of this just helps us to think through, troubleshoot, and to set the birds up for pairing success. And finally, after all of that preparation, we reach a point where we're actually socializing our birds. So in the majority of cases, we use visual barriers, such as tennis netting, to help the birds feel more comfortable and safe when placed next to a new bird. Cranes can also be very aggressive, even through the fencing. So the visual barrier allows the birds to get to know each other first by sound and through limited visual contact. One of the first steps to socializing is incrementally removing the visual barrier and allowing them more visual access to each other. During this stage, we're really working the socialization until we see behaviors that signal that the birds are enjoying each other's company. So a lot of times you'll see the birds preen or forage together across from one another. You'll see them do synchronous behaviors. They'll use the house at the same time. They'll call together. One of the really fun things about socializations, I think, is when you first put two birds together and they start calling, the call sounds, again, for lack of a better word, really awful. So it's not in sync. It kind of starts and stops. It just sounds really rough. And then as they kind of spend more time together and they start calling together and they start doing some bonding through the calling together, you'll start to actually hear the call sound more in sync, it'll go longer. And that's a really nice key point that'll kind of show you as the aviculturist that your birds are probably ready to actually physically be put together. And a lot of times during this time period too, hopefully, if you see a few threats in the beginning, hopefully those are starting to disappear as they spend more time just visually being able to see each other and spend time across from each other. And then when you're comfortable at that point, it's pretty much time to physically put them together. And so this is accomplished by either giving the birds the choice to self-combine. That's one of the things that I actually prefer to do, is I'll usually just open a divider gate and I'll let them kind of combine on their own. Or sometimes we'll actually move the male over into the female's yard, because the female is usually the less dominant bird and she'll feel more comfortable and willing to defend herself if she's in a familiar space, if she's in her own space. So when we're first putting birds together, we don't give them access to resources such as food and water or the house. And the time spent together is usually brief, about 30 minutes to 60 minutes. And then we'll usually start expanding on that time period, or we might add food and water or the house. And the reason that we don't add food and water or give them access to the house is that those are really big resources to birds. And so a lot of times they disagree over resources. And so we want to first put them together where they have nothing else that's sort of in the way. And then the socialization progresses again to adding food and water out in the yard. We usually use two in food water stations at the same time at first. And so we have multiple places that birds can go to eat. So if one bird displaces or pushes the other bird away from food, or sometimes they'll even guard food and water, they'll kind of stand at the food and water and they won't let the other bird come up to food and water. There's always a second place that that second bird can go to get food and water. And so as I probably mentioned before, usually the sharing of resources is where a lot of the challenges are faced. And so you kind of work through those challenges by adjusting how far away your food and water is, maybe where the placement of the food and water is, and things like that. And then once the birds are using food and water well together, and it's usually nice to see them using a single food and water station together, then you can move on to adding house access. And again, the house is another big resource. It's where they're protected from the weather. A lot of our females actually like to nest inside of the house. So the house is kind of important to them. And so at this point, when you give them access to the house, it almost feels like you start the socialization all over again because you've just added this new resource and the birds need to sort of relearn how to share without getting snippy with each other. And then hopefully at this point, once you're kind of getting the birds good with food and water and with the house, hopefully the socialization has progressed into the new year. So we've moved from the fall, hopefully into more of the winter. And the birds are spending most of the day together. So they might be put together in the morning and then separated at night, but they're pretty much spending the entire day together. And then one day, it's sort of unceremonious. You decide to keep them together overnight. It's exciting, but not exciting all at the same time. It's exciting that you've kind of reached a point that you can put birds together. But it's sort of just like there should be no doubt in your mind. You know that they're going to do well. And today is just the day that they're going to spend the night together. And that's pretty much when they're paired. Or is it? So I'm going to leave you with that little cliffhanger. And we're going to kind of switch gears a little bit to talking a little bit more about, we've sort of talked through like what the actual technique is for socialization. And so we're going to talk a little bit more about what do we see within those socializations. And so the steps to socialization, again, are all very straightforward. The challenge in socializations usually or typically lies in interpreting the bird's behavior and the interactions and figuring out how to help the birds feel more comfortable with each other. And so all of the crane species share the majority of behaviors, but there are certain behaviors that may be more prevalent in some species versus other species. So knowing the species repertoire is really important. Siberians are obviously gonna have different behaviors than say Eurasian cranes or sandhill cranes or crown cranes. And also depending on the rearing history of the individual birds, you might see the presence or absence of certain behaviors which you wouldn't expect to see. So that goes back to if we have a bird in the collection who is cross-fostered and they might actually show a couple of behaviors that maybe are a little bit weird or and which the other bird doesn't really respond to. And so you might face some challenges there and you have to figure out why the birds are having challenges in that sort of way. Oops, sorry guys. The other thing that usually comes up as well is sort of what are the behaviors within the context of the environment. So if there's something going on outside of the pen, husbandry work is going on or maintenance work is going on, the birds are going to respond to that. And so you might actually see them responding to the outside influences versus actually responding directly to something that the other bird is doing. And so you kind of have to keep all of that in mind as well. And so the behaviors and interactions between the birds are almost like trying to figure out a mystery and determining if the pair is heading in a positive direction or not. And so these are just some photos. I think as we were doing our practice, some of the photos are cut off a little bit. These photos are pictures of what we call discordant or sort of disagreeable behaviors. And these are behaviors you'll sort of see if the birds aren't getting along very well. Again, if the behaviors are directed towards one another. These are all really threat behaviors that cranes use to defend territory or to warn that they will attack. So at the top there, we have just a basic strut walk. We kind of move raised tertials and strut walk. We kind of go from sort of minor threats all the way up to the charge and the crouch threat as really advanced. The birds should really take warning of this because they're going to attack with that behavior warning. And so these are just a couple of things that we look for when we're going through and doing our socializations. And a lot of times when you start the socialization, you'll sort of see many of these behaviors. And then hopefully as you progress through the socialization, you see less of these behaviors, or you actually see the birds doing these behaviors together towards an outside influence. These are just some pair-related behaviors in which well-bonded pairs will do together. And during the socializations, a lot of these are actually comfort or maintenance behaviors such as eating and drinking. Their calls are obviously, especially as I was talking about before, if their calls start sounding really in sync and nice, that kind of helps signal that bond is forming. Obviously, many of you that are aware of cranes know about the dance. And then another thing is a lot of times when you see birds within socializations and they're lying sternal or they're roosting on one leg or they're tucking their head to sleep, those are actually really good behaviors to see because it tells you that the birds are comfortable with one another. They don't feel like they have to be vigilant and have to watch the other bird. And so that's always really positive to see as well. So even though they're not as exciting, this is really what we like to look for. We like to look for calm and doing things together to let us know that they're starting to bond and feel at the very least tolerant of one another. So there are a few ways in which we can encourage positive interactions or sort of manipulate the birds to have greater success during the socialization. We've discussed using visual barriers to help birds feel more comfortable and safe. If you have a very energetic bird or dominant bird, you can use temporary flight restraint methods, such as just clipping the wings to help slow the energetic bird down during chases. It can help put them off balance during dances, or it can knock them down a peg. And it helps the other bird feel a little bit more comfortable and feel like they can stand up to themselves or stand up for themselves within the pairing. It helps, it kind of provides an opportunity for the more submissive bird to feel safer while it's gaining confidence within sort of having this new bird within its space. One thing that we don't use very often anymore, but sometimes we naturally find these in our yards, are confidence mounds. And these are just mounds of dirt that can be used to, again, provide the more submissive bird with confidence by letting that bird be a little bit more physically taller than the other bird. We also use things like socialization ponds, treats, food, water. They can all be used to see how birds react to important resources and sort of the fun things. And this will often reveal the challenges that still lie between the pair. So usually when I'm starting to reach the point where birds are staying together all day, I'll usually use items like this to kind of test the birds. So I'll use treats, or sometimes we use some enrichment items just to see if the birds will approach that item together. We'll see if there is a bird that kind of displaces or pushes the other bird off of those items. And that kind of will let you know sort of where, again, some of those challenges might still be within your socialization. And then this is one of my favorite things that I actually like to use. During the breeding season, we can often try to have birds that we are hoping to socialize in the future, we can have them nest and incubate, quote unquote, together across from one another. And so a lot of times by letting them do this, this will help to create a bond and set the pair up to be more successful with either the socialization as well as incubating eggs in the future as a pair. And so a lot of times you'll actually, the female will usually either start building a nest or will lay her eggs first. And then you'll actually see the male next to her. He will build his own little nest. And then we can provide him with a dummy egg and they'll actually incubate and sit together. And sometimes you'll even see the female get off the nest to go eat and the male will stay on his nest. She'll come back to her nest and then he'll leave to actually eat. And they kind of almost do a nest switch or an incubation switch. And again, that just helps when you're not actually in the fall and winter, but you're in the breeding season, you're still actually working on the socialization and kind of helping to create that bond, even though you don't have the birds together. And so I really like to use this technique because I also help manage our incubation here for pairs in particular that we're hoping to use as surrogate incubators, because sometimes it tends to actually help you use that pair faster in the future once they're paired. You can actually use them sooner for incubating eggs. At least I feel like you can. So here's where I have a couple of videos. And so I'll explain them a little bit first because they go a little bit fast. But this is a pair of demoiselle cranes. This is Gracie and Caspian. And this is a pair of cranes that we recently re-socialized as a pair. So they were transferred to our institution as a pair. And then during the breeding season, we had to separate them for aggression and for safety issues. And now this past summer, we've worked to re-socialize them together. So this is them out in Crane City in a socialization pen. And they had like this weird obsession with this corner. And we're not happy campers when they were in this corner together. I don't know if they just really enjoyed the corner, or sometimes when the corners are small like that, it makes them feel like they can't protect themselves, like they get trapped in the corner. So we have Gracie is the bird that's in the forefront here with her wings out. That's the female, and she starts dancing. And then you'll actually see a number of threats being expressed by Caspian the male. And hopefully you can look and see if you see these, but he does a little, he crowns her. He does a bow down ruffle. And then she responds with the same. He makes a little chase and some contact. Again, more bow down ruffles. And Caspian then struts, does a strut walk away from her. And she doesn't really get the hint, but we'll see if this video works for you guys. So that's her bopping around, starting to dance. There's his bow down ruffle. She does the same thing. He's gonna chase a little bit of contact. Again, more bow down ruffle. Here's his strut walk and she's just gonna bop alongside him, not really taking the hint that he didn't like that. And again, we're gonna go through the same motions. And then this time, this is where the video will stop, but she actually gets the hint this time and she'll finally just move away and she goes along on her business, on her business. So that's some of the things that you might see if birds are disagreeing and they're not really enjoying their time together. So this pair in particular, we actually made a change where we were able to move them up to our exhibit area into a larger space. And that seems really weird because these are the smallest species of crane, but they actually needed a larger a larger area to sort of work out all the kinks and so that we could re-socialize them. So they've done much better in the larger space and have come back into a really nice pair so far. And so we'll see if this continues through the next breeding season as well, if they hold true to their pairing through the next breeding season. This next video is a pair of whooping cranes. And I'm sure many of you have seen this before. This is a pair of whooping cranes during a socialization. And this is really just a happy dance party. So I'm showing 30 seconds of this video, but this dance section lasted about over 2 minutes, about 2.5 minutes. And whooping cranes in particular, along with a couple of other species, they do a lot of runs and chases in their dance. And there's a part in the dance where you'll see that they do some open bill jabs. And that's what actually tells you that this is happy dancing and not angry dancing. So there's a lot of little things and a lot of little behaviors, especially within dance, but a lot of little minute things and minute differences in the behaviors that will tell you whether it's sort of agreeable or disagreeable. Happy, happy. So just a lot of fun, windy day, dancing, having a good time. All right. So then, as I mentioned a few slides ago, one of the final steps to the socialization process is keeping the birds together overnight. But as I kind of teased you guys, that's not the end. One of the interesting things is February 14th, Valentine's Day, actually marks the beginning of our breeding season for our department. So that's sort of the date that we mark that we have to limit disturbances in Crane City and that we start to get ready to watch for breeding behaviors and things like that. It's really in February that that happens. And the breeding season brings some possible new challenges as reproductive hormones increase in the birds. They may decide that they aren't as tolerant of each other as they were in the winter. And so one of our focuses in the breeding season is to document the breeding behaviors of select pairs. And that usually involves the new pairs that we had socialized that past winter. And this not only allows us to just monitor the birds through the breeding season, but it also gives us a chance to see how the pair progresses through the breeding season. And usually over subsequent seasons, you'll kind of see more breeding behaviors happen. So you might see a lot of unison calling or dancing during the first season. You might see some pre-copulation calling, but you maybe won't see soliciting or anything like that. And then maybe the following year, you'll start to see some soliciting and some copulation attempts. And maybe they'll lay an egg and maybe they'll attempt to incubate, but they won't be very good at it. And then the third season, maybe they'll actually move into being, you know, a fully functional pair of cranes. Some of the pairs actually get it right away, and it's especially the birds that are the older birds that have actually gone through pairings before and have had the experience of laying eggs and incubating and breeding and things like that. And the younger pairs, it kind of takes them a little bit to sort of solidify that bond and to kind of figure out what they're supposed to be doing. So then, and then sometimes in the breeding season, you might actually see that the birds, they aren't really as tolerant of each other. And then you have to sort of take those safety concerns in mind, and you may have to actually split the pair. And then you may have to try and re-socialize them the next season, the next winter. So after many months to many years, after all of the work and actually a lot of patience and a lot of time, hopefully the journey ends here with paired birds, happily paired birds. And they provide companionship to one another while inspiring people to care about cranes. They hopefully develop into a reproductive pair that incubates eggs, rears chicks, and provides valuable genetic material to the captive population. And really, when our birds are happy with their mate, that brings joy to CCD in particular, but I'm sure to everybody that comes on site and sees all of our wonderful birds. So with that, now is the time for you guys to ask your questions. While we answer them, I will leave you with this photo. This is one of my favorite pairs of cranes here at ICF. And it's actually one of the pairs that Jessica and I worked together to socialize 2 or 3 years ago now. These are wattled cranes, Nagami and Nasumbu, and this is them on their giant nest in February, actually 3 days before Valentine's Day. So with that, Jessica, if you have any questions that are coming in, I am free to answer them.
Yes. So great job, Cyndie. Always love talking about socializations. Got a couple of good questions coming in. So the first one for you is, what ages are ideal for matching? And is there an age a bird is considered too old to match?
That's a really good question. And I'm sure each one of our aviculturists would say something different. So I'm just going to speak with in regards to my experience. What I have found with through a couple of years of doing this and doing socializations at a couple of other institutions is the younger the birds are, the easier it is to socialize. And especially if they have been on their own at another institution, they usually just want the companionship and they really haven't reached that age of sexual maturity. And so it usually goes really smoothly to do those socializations. I think Nagami and Nasumbu, when we socialized them, they were probably, don't quote me on this, 2 and 3 years old or 3 and 4 years old. And we had a little difficulties in the beginning, but as far as socializations, it was pretty smooth because they were fairly young birds. I don't know if there's an age where it's too old, if there's a bird that's too old to socialize. I don't know if there's really an age where a bird would be too old to socialize. I think as birds age, they have typically been in long-term mate situations, in long-term relationships, you could say. And so when you have birds that have been together for some of our pairs, some of them have been together for decades and then they lose their mate, that's a really hard transition to go sort of from one bird that they've been with for many, many years to another bird. So sometimes that can just bring challenges just because of how long they have been paired. Really where the challenges lie is just a lot of times in the differences of rearing history and things like that. It works really well if you have a bird that's, I want to say it works really well. So I feel like it works really well when birds are, say like 10 or 12 and like a female's 10 or 12 and she's been laying eggs and has kind of gone through being reproductive for a couple of years. And then you bring in a younger bird who's maybe 5 or 8 or something like that, but he hasn't quite had that experience yet. I think that usually works out really well because the female kind of knows what she's doing, or male, vice versa. And he can sort of learn from her, and that usually goes really well. It's really all, like, I feel like a lot of it is dependent on the actual individual and just what their experience has been.
Awesome. So next question for you. Somebody was curious about SSPs. So they asked which institutions are primarily responsible for SSPs for each crane species?
Oh man, go to the ABA website. That's testing me. There have been a couple of new SSP program leaders that have come into play. What I will tell you, so there are currently 10 SSPs for cranes. Here at ICF, we actually have 2 program leaders. So we have our curator, Kim Boardman, is the SSP coordinator, the program leader for whooping cranes. And then for demoiselle cranes is actually myself. So I'm the SSP coordinator for demoiselle cranes. And so there's typically a single individual that applies to be an SSP program leader, and they're approved by what is known as the Taxon Advisory Group. So it's the TAG is full of a number of individuals that specifically have quite a bit of experience with cranes, and they kind of approve who they want as the program leader. And then it's really dependent on for each of those programs. For like demoiselles, demoiselle cranes, we have 22 institutions that, or AZA institutions that are part of the SSP program for demoiselles. And usually each institution only has one pair of birds. It kind of depends on what their own personal collection goals are and things like that, and what sort of programs they want to focus on. But yeah, it really depends. And the program leaders, usually a lot of the crane program leaders have been with these programs for many, many years. I've been with the demoiselle program for six years now, maybe. So yeah, that's kind of the gist of it.
Okay, so next question, let's scroll up. Somebody was asking, if a couple are successful and like each other, do you keep that pair together after they've had chicks, or would you split them up the next breeding season?
Yeah, so usually what we do is when we are socializing new pairs of birds, right now what we've kind of been talking about is we give them three seasons to see what they're going to do together. And then after three breeding seasons, if they don't look like, according to sort of our breeding observations, is if they don't look like they're progressing as a reproductive pair, there's not a lot of like copulation attempts seen, there's eggs aren't laid, things like that, then we start looking at that pairing and we start thinking about, should we actually split that pair? If a pair is actually producing chicks and rearing chicks, very rarely will we split that pair, especially in terms of whooping cranes. That's very valuable for us because we need whooping crane pairs to be able to parent rear chicks. And so, like I said, that's where if the genetics would ever change on those two individuals, we can actually kind of control the genetics so we can keep that pair intact. So they continue to lay eggs, incubate, and rear chicks, which is very, very valuable for us.
Okay. Let's see, you answered that. So next question, what is the success rate, attempt / successful pairings we have had here at ICF?
It's pretty darn close to 100%. So I have been with ICF for 7 years, and I think, if I can think correctly, I think there's probably only one or two pairs within that time period that we've tried to pair that just haven't worked. And so we've tried them for a couple of years and they just aren't working out. And so we'll find them a new mate. But usually we're pretty successful. And again, it kind of depends on what your main goal is for the actual pair. Are you just hoping to provide them with better welfare for having a companion? Well, then we might, as long as they're tolerating each other and as long as they seem like they're doing well together, and then that's the goal met. If it's more whooping cranes and we're looking for them to actually be able to lay eggs or rear chicks, then, you know, we want to make sure that pair is actually progressing and actually forming a really strong bond so you actually meet that goal. So it depends a little bit, but I think we've been pretty successful because our staff has been working with cranes for many years. I've been here 7 years. but we have people on our staff that have been here 30 years and 10 years. And so we know our birds really, really well. And I think we would make really good choices in terms of who we can actually think we're going to be able to successfully pair together. So that's why it works out so well, I think. We know our birds.
Yes. Okay. So somebody asked how many pairs we currently have in Crane City, or I guess exhibits two.
Yeah, so I thought this was going to be asked and I didn't actually count it. So we have roughly 110 birds on site. I would probably say we have close to 30 to 40 pairs. We have quite a lot of pairs.
Okay. Somebody asked the question if our birds, we're trying to socialize, if they're on site, or do we ever have to import them for breeding?
Yeah, so all of the birds that we socialize are on site. When we're talking about programs like the SSP programs, that's where we might get transfer recommendations, where we may have a single white-naped crane here at ICF, and she's a female, and we are looking to find a mate for her, bring in a male white-naped crane for her. The SSP is the one who would actually look at what kind of surplus birds they have in the captive population, and look at the genetics, and they would usually identify an appropriate individual for ICF to bring in order for us to pair. So that's kind of where sort of the transfers come in and things like that. But all of the socializations happen here at ICF.
Okay. Another question for you. Do you have a favorite pair that you've ever socialized?
I have a lot of favorite bears. So I have to say, every pair I work with, I think, has become my favorite because I've worked with them, because the socializations really cause you to really, really get to know the birds at a really deep, intimate level. So I've done a couple of Siberian pairs, and I really enjoy socializing Siberians. They're one of my favorite crane species just in general. But I think one of the other pairs that is my favorite is a pair of black neck cranes. They're actually two females that we socialized together in hopes that they would become surrogate incubators for our whooping crane eggs. And at the time, I really wasn't gung-ho about black neck cranes, but I have found that through working with these two individuals that I really like black neck cranes now. But they also had the challenge of one of them was cross-fostered and one of them is hand-reared. So there are a lot of things that happened during that socialization that caused me to actually go back to articles and go back to sort of their records and things like that, and figure out like, why is this bird doing this? And this bird is not understanding what this bird is telling them. So they were really fun just because of the challenge of they were two females and they had different rearing backgrounds. And then it also had the ultimate goal of wanting them to be surrogate incubators and things like that. So that's also, they're probably have become one of my favorite pairs as well, just because I worked with them through the socialization period.
Okay. So last question for you. How can we, as outsiders, how can we help?
Yeah, so most of you are likely aware that ICF is a donor-supported organization. And this is very true for Crane Conservation Department. So memberships, general financial support is actually what allows us to care for our captive flock. It's really difficult to apply for grants or to find grant funding that will pay for food for your birds. But in addition, folks can help CCD by going to our website and adopting a crane or becoming a crane keeper. All of that actually helps support all the care that we do here on site. We have a wish list where people can help support us through purchasing enrichment items for our flock. And then finally, this is during sort of normal, obviously non-COVID times, but ICF has a wonderful group of volunteers that help us, and CCD is no different. So we do have people that volunteer with our department to help help with the husbandry work of our adult flock and help us care for our adult flock. And hopefully when we can bring people back on site and we can all work together during normal circumstances, we can expand on that program in the future.
Okay, so it doesn't look like any more questions for you.
Great. So again, I would really like to thank Dick and Jane Dana for their support in sponsoring this webinar. If you all out there would like to sponsor one of our webinars, you can contact Kate Fitzwilliam. Her contact information, I'm sure you all have seen that before. And then I just want to do a shout out for our next webinar next week, Thursday at 11 a.m. Please join us to hear from one of our ICF volunteers on why we love cranes. And so I just want to do another thank you all for joining me, and I hope you enjoyed learning a bit more about our captive flock and the work that we do within ICF's Crane Conservation Department. And I hope everyone enjoys the rest of your day.